In the name of Allah, the most graceful and merciful, greetings everyone. Good morning and assalamu alaikum. Let us all have a moment of silence for the recitation of Quran by Miss Anira Khalil and translation by Miss Zoya Asad.
أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم ألم نشرح لك صدرك ووضعنا عنك وزرك الذي أنقذ ظهرك ورفعنا لك ذكرك فإن مع العسر يسرا إن مع العسر يسرا فإذا فرغت فانصب وإلى ربك فارغب آمنت بالله صدق الله العظيم.
I seek protection in Allah from the accursed Satan. In the name of Allah, the most gracious, the most merciful. Did we not expand for you your chest, and we removed from you your burden, which had weighed upon your back, and raised high for you your repute? So indeed, along with hardship, there is ease. Indeed, along with hardship, there is ease. So when you have finished your duties, then stand up for worship, and to your Lord direct your longing.
Welcome back for the section of today. And thank you for joining us on the International Conference on Trends in Natural Sciences from Basics to Applied. I would like to invite Dr. R.S.N. Janjua and Dr. Kashfa Naghmana Wahid to please come on the stage. Please welcome. Before I introduce both of them, we would like to play a video on Blue Revolution. It's a documentary video.
Thank you.
सही मैम, अबस मैम इनका स्टार्ट करा देना है डॉक्टर आर एस एन जो आपने इंट्रोडक्शन दे के अपना बता देना. सही है मैम. मैम डॉक्टर शगुफ्ता नाम से कर लेते हैं ना,
कहाँ
यहाँ पे ऊपर
वो आ रही हैं आती हैं ना, तो
मैं इनको बता दूँ,
मैं इनको खुद ही कह दूँगी, खुद ही दे रहा हूँ.
सही,
आप बस इनका
इंट्रोडक्शन में
और उसके बाद डॉक्टर काशिफा नहीं बस उनको चुप करके बैठी कर देंगे.
सही,
अब आपने डॉक्टर काशिफा के टॉक चलाए,
मैं इन्वाइट आर एस एन जिन जो कि नहीं चलाई इनके बारे में इंट्रोडक्शन दे दी. सतारा सिंह जिंजुआ साहब ने जिस से ऑर्डर चाहते हैं,
हाँ तो बस इन दोनों से वंडरफुल डॉक्टर आया था फ्रॉम डॉक्टर जिंजुआ. ठीक है, नेक्स्ट डॉक्टर फ्रॉम,
ठीक है मैं उनको इंट्रोड्यूस करके फिर
पिछड़ा करके उसके बाद बच्चों को,
ठीक है
बस ये दो संभालो फिर अगला.
ठीक है, Northern Crop Institute, Northern Dakota State University, Illinois State University, Arizona University, and Utah State University and Asian Institute of Technology, Thailand. He's graduated courses of agriculture extruded feed manufacturing with soy from Kansas State University. He has more than 35 years of working experience in private sector. Since April 1998, is associated with American Soybean Association as country representative and have vast experience of sector development programs funded by USDA and USAID and experts in development of industry, linkage program between academia, research and private sector, transfer of technology. He is speaker at number of national and international conferences, including representatives and presenting papers at World Agriculture Society's annual conference in USA, and with of different publications of poultry, dairy, agriculture, nutrition, uses of soy. Since 2012, he is chief of party feeding Pakistan program for promotion of agriculture sector of America's Soybean Association funded by USDA, and trained more than 100 males and females graduates in fisheries and 1,000 fish farms. He introduced Training Institute. She did her master's in philosophy and doctorate from Punjab University, with a double gold medalist and master's in chemistry from Government College, University. Her fields of interest lies in analytical and environmental chemistry, fishery, nutrition, and life sciences. She has a number of publications in impact for journals, internationally and nationally, out of which 25 are her recent publications. Her research is mostly done in the fishery sector. Today, she is going to be delivering her lecture on exploring the futuristic potentials of sustainable fisheries and aquacultures in contribution towards global nutrition demands, issues, constraints, and challenges. Please welcome Dr. Kashifa.
I am highly thankful to the Faculty of Biotechnology and Zoology for inviting me on this prestigious occasion. And of course, thanks, Dr. Abel, for introducing me to the forum. Dear audience, the title of my today's presentation is Exploring the Futuristic Potential of Sustainable Fisheries and Aquaculture in Contribution Towards Global Nutrition Demands, Issues, Constraints, and Challenges. Introduction. The global fisheries and aquaculture production sustainability needs special attention. It is a dire need of the time to ensure the futuristic nutrition security of the coming generations. The FNA has played a significant role in eliminating hunger, promoting health, and reducing poverty. Never before the people have consumed so much fish, are depended so greatly on the sector for their well-being as now. Since fish is not only extremely nutritious but also a vital source of protein and essential nutrients, especially for many poorer members of our global community. The F&A sector provides jobs to tens of millions and supports the livelihood of hundreds of millions. Of course, fish nurtures superfeed. You can see how it is a superfood. You can see it has vitamins, calcium, it has iron, it has zinc, and omega fatty acids, proteins, etc. The fisheries, aquaculture, and livelihood. Asia is the most dominating in this sector, providing the most of the fisheries, aquaculture, this livelihood, employment, and gender. 10.8 million of females are engaged in this sector. And again, Asia, you can see from the red, the Asia is the dominant one. 19% women are engaged in the primary sector, while 50% are engaged in the primary and secondary sector. This is a comparison of top five countries which are key producers and traders. All around the world, it has grown steadily in the last many decades. However, supply and gap has also been widened up and victimized its own success through dramatically increased fish exploitation trends in the past three decades, which have posed serious risks to the sector. An essential requirement for ensuring sustainable fisheries and aquaculture through good policies and management starts from the provision of standardized, reliable, and up-to-date objective information on the past and present status of F&A. So, for stabilization of global fluid economy, it is extremely important to see into the seen and unseen issues, the latest available statistics, constraints and challenges coming ahead that can be faced by the sector and can be a serious threat in the next coming decades. It is also an essential requirement to develop good policies and management appropriate international mechanisms and standards for ensuring sustainable F&A sector. So here are some statistics you can compare from these. The fish production, these are based on the reports of FAO 2014-16-17, the Food and Agriculture Organization of the United States Rome, the United Nations Industrial Development Organization, UNIDO, report 2017, the NIFIS report, National Institute of Nutrition and Seafood Research, 2017, the NASF report 2017, National Association for Surface Fishing, and the Organization for Economic Cooperation and Development, OECD, report 2017. These statistics are taken from these reports. So you can see the fishery sector, the fish production in the capture that was almost equal to the aquaculture till almost 1986, but it started progressing from there, and now you can see the aquaculture is dominating, almost double the capture side. Then fish production and utilization. The non-food uses are depicted by yellow, and you can see the capture for human consumption and the per capita food fish supply, which was not met before, but now it is easily met due to the more developed aquaculture sector. This statistic shows the aquaculture surpass. You can see the line that was quite below, and the dramatic change, no doubt, is a positive increase observed in aquaculture after 2014, which is evident from this line graph. And the aquaculture surpass easily noticeable, which goes beyond the capture for food and total capture. These are the bar graphs which shows the aquaculture surpass from 2015 onwards. Initially, aquaculture industry was very less, which has grown quite better in the last four decades and equalizes the capture for food. It is expected that the aquaculture will dominate the total capture till 2025. The fish contribution towards human consumption, these are the different, you can see a comparison of group of countries, and some groups of countries including in Oceania group and LIFDCs, low income food deficient countries. So Oceania is actually smallest continental grouping, including Australasia, Melanesia, Polynesia, Micronesia, and Australasia, including Australia also. So these are islands. And then LIFDCs, these countries were initially 82 countries, which were, and at that time, the China was also a part of it. But it dropped subsequently to 70, and now there are only 52 countries left. And the drop countries included China, Guinea, Morocco. The Pakistan is included in these countries, LIFDCs countries. So the below the world, you can see the bars. This is the average values showing for both the per capita consumption and the share of fish. Per capita fish consumption now and future expectations. Of course, the demand is increasing day by day, and there are statistics where we stand now and where we will move further in the future. Fish production and traded share. The whole world can be observed from these bars groups. The export side is almost half of the quantity produced. You can see from there, from these bar graphs. And the fish and fishery product export value, you can see that in 1976 we were only have $10 billion value of fish and fishery products exports, which have now touched almost $150 billion in 2014, and this is increasing quite sharply. These are the net exports of various products of developing countries. So you can see that how the fish is dominating these products. The highest one is the fish products, which have been the fish commodity, which has been maximum exported during from the these countries. Now we come to the issues, constraints and challenges. We see. Number one, resource and environment. Environmental degradation and habitat destruction has been taken in our global, you know, world. Loss of biodiversity has taken place, over exploitation of fish stocks, biosecurity, disease outbreaks, climatic change, of course, ocean acidification have happened due to acid rains, stock migrations and severe weather conditions, etc., have changed the scenario. Then there are socio-economic and governance issues, overcapacity, fleets and labor by catch and discards, access to capital and financial services. Of course, all the people don't have access to these, including loans, insurance, equity, poverty, forced labor and child labor are the basic issues. Public image of fisheries and aquaculture is needs to be enhanced. Then the relationship between fisheries management policy, allocation of rights and the economic suitability of the sector, distribution of margins and benefits for the fisheries value chain, and the most stringent rules for quality and safety of fish products, including for imported products in several countries. The requirement for new traceability system. Now we should move to the ISO certification, accreditation and certification all over the world. They are moving towards it, so we should also move there. The economic crisis and the risk of increased import barriers and tariffs like fees, excise duty, etc. Distortions caused by harmful forms of fish subsides, including those that can contribute to overfishing and depletion of fish stocks. The issues, constraints and challenges explained earlier need special concentration of all the authorities, responsible authorities, of course, worldwide, and these need to be rectified for moving towards good aquaculture practices. The message of the day is the sustainability of fishes and aquaculture production is crucial to the livelihood, food security and nutrition of billions of people. So fishes suitability is only possible if development that meets the need of the present without compromising the ability of the future generation to meet their own needs. So these were the references, and thanks.
All right, moving forward, we are going to be having a Skype session with Dr. Subhash Hajeri from Central California, Tristiza Education Agency, USA. His title is RNA in Insect Pest Management. Please welcome for a Skype lecture with him.
Effect of various levels of iron on peroxidase activity in fish. Please welcome Ms. Komal Sabal.
Respected guests and all the dear members, Assalamu alaikum. I am Komal Sabal from University of Agriculture, Faisalabad. And the topic of my presentation is effect of various levels of iron on peroxidase activity in the fish Sirhinum mrigala. Pakistan is a growing economy now, and industrialization has evolved through the decades, and metals have been the major utilization products in the industries. Many of these heavy metals, when released in water, induce oxidative stress in the fish by generating reactive oxygen species, which result in the oxidation of proteins, lipids, and nucleic acids. Many of these heavy metals cause the reactive oxygen species production. To minimize the hazardous impact of RAS on cells, there exists an antioxidant event system in the fish whose enzymes work to cope up with the oxidative stress. My research objective was to determine the effect of iron on peroxidase activity in the fish Sirhinum regala, as it is one of the most cultured fish species of Pakistan, and it attains the size of market size of 0.8 to 1 kg in less than a year. The experimental size was the fisheries research farms of Department of Zoology, Wildlife and Fisheries, University of Agriculture, Faisalabad. Four groups of fish were exposed to sublethal concentrations of 96 or LC50, 2/3, 1/4, 1/5, and of LC50 values of iron chloride. And the experiment was conducted with three replications for each test concentration. Another group of fish regarded as control was kept in the metal-free media. After 30 days of iron exposure, the fish were dissected and their gills, liver, kidney, and brain tissues were then isolated and stored at minus 4 degrees Celsius for enzyme assay. To perform the enzyme assay, the liver, gills, kidney, and brain of the fish were rinsed with the phosphate buffer at pH 6.5 and later on homogenized in cold buffer of 1:4 ratio by using a blender to remove RBCs from the tissues. The mixture was then centrifuged at 10,000 rounds per minute for 15 minutes at 4 degrees Celsius, and supernatant was preserved at minus 4 degrees Celsius for enzyme assay. The samples were subjected to enzyme assay for the determination of peroxidase activity. The enzyme peroxidase activity was determined spectrophotometrically at the wavelength of 470 nanometer by measuring its conversion of guaiacol to tetragaiacol. Statistical analysis was performed to deduct the results. Factorial experiments were performed with three replications for each test concentration to find out statistical differences among various sublethal concentrations of iron. The means were compared using LST, and the correlation and regression analysis were also performed to find out statistical relationships among different parameters under study. The results showed that among all four organs, gills were the most susceptible and had the highest peroxidase activity. This was due to the reason that gills are prone to the more contact with water and they are directly contaminated with the metals. Here, there is a comparison between the control fish gills and the stressed fish gills. The stressed fish gills showed extremely high level of peroxidase activity, which is showing that there is a higher level of metal concentration which is in contact with the gills and that is entering into the body of the fish. Here you can see the stressed fish liver has higher peroxidase activity and the controlled fish liver has the lower value. Same is with the kidney and same is with the brain. But brain as compared to all other organs. Here you can see that brain has the least activity of peroxidase enzyme. Activity of peroxidase enzyme in the metal stress gills, liver, kidney and brain were reported to be 0.697, 0.584, 0.456 and 0.287 micron milliliters respectively, while in the control group these values were 0.119, 0.111, 0.107 and 0.024 micron milliliter among the control group fish. The results concluded that peroxidase activity was found to be metal concentration dependent, as significantly higher activity was recorded in 96 or LC50 exposed fish group, while significantly lower activity was found in the control fish group. Thank you.
Thank you so much, sir. I would like to invite our next speaker, Dr. Zafar Iqbal from Punjab University, Lahore. He will be presenting to you fungal infection in tilapia fish cultured in ponds. Please welcome Dr. Zafar Iqbal.
Thank you. Honorable Chairperson and two co-chairperson, respective audience, my dear students, I say very good morning to you. And it is great pleasure for me to be here this morning to give this small presentation. As told, I'm Dr. Zafar from Punjab University and I work on fish diseases. Well, this is the short presentation about fungal infection in tilapia fish. Tilapia, you know, it's a fish and belongs to family cichlidae, and there are over 100 cichlid species in this group, and this fish is native of Africa and Middle East, and it is very, very important in fisheries and aquaculture worldwide. Well, tilapia from the historical perspective was caught from the Sea of Galilee in biblical times, that was around 2000 years back, and this is the current picture of the Sea of Galilee in Israel in Palestine. Economically, tilapia has three important species, which is dial tilapia or Euchromis neloticus. It can go up to 4.32 kilogram and length could go up to 60 centimeter. Blue tilapia, Euchromis aureus, and Mozambique tilapia. And if we talk about the trade, tilapia trade is US around 7.5 billion and estimated production is 5 million tons that was reported by Kevin in 2015. Characteristics, tilapia is mainly a freshwater fish but can survive in brackish and salt water, that is in salton sea. And tilapia become invasive species in warm water habitat such as Pakistan. Tilapia is labeled as disease resistant fish. However, it slow to show outbreak of disease in presence of pathogens. Diseases of tilapia, if we go in literature, we could find a couple of diseases in tilapia that has been reported, and the most recent is the tilapia virus, a lake virus that was reported in 2016. Bacteria, we have streptococcus, eriemannos, from fungal, we have Eclea, Saprolegnia, Ephemenis, Fusarium, and Oxysporium. These are parasite, protozoan, and monogenia, these are all been reported. I have myself reviewed diseases in freshwater fishes in Punjab, Pakistan. This study was aimed to find fungal infection in some of these fishes. And experiment fish was obtained from Punjab University Research Fish Farm and fish hatcheries in Lahore. Fish was brought live to fish disease and health management lab. Fishes were examined clinically according to NOGA 2010 and under guidelines of the Ethical Committee of PU Lahore. This is the lab where this study was conducted, my lab, two of my undergraduate students. Well, material from affected area of the fish, fins, eye, skin, operculum, gills, was inoculated on agar plates for 5 to 7 days at 28 to 30 degrees centigrade, and two types of agar, SDA and PDA, were used. 9 plates were prepared from each fish. Total 360 plates were used for 2 fish sample. Slides were prepared from fungal colonies for identification. Trap and glue in lactophanol was used for staining. Two species of tilapia were studied, blue tilapia and red belly tilapia. Clinical signs showed by these fishes were ruptured dorsal and caudal fins and quade coloration. 49 out of 180 plates and 52 out of 180 plates showed growth of fungus in sample 1 and sample 2. Fungal colonies of different colors and shapes appeared in agar plates. Well, these are the two disease sample of the fish. Right is the blue tilapia and The left, right one is the red belly. Gray, black, white, yellow, green, pinkish white, orange and brown colonies appeared on the egg plates. 15 out of 20 fishes were infected, 16 in second sample, 5 fungal genera, Aspergillus, Blastomyces, Alternaria, Mucor, and one was unidentified. Hyphae were from this fish. 6 fungal genera were isolated from second sample, that was red belly tilapia. They were Blastomyces, Aspergillus, Alternaria, Mucor, Fusarium, and one unidentified hyphae from this fish. Well, this is the colony, and that is the result of one of the Aspergillus fishes. This is another one. This is a Mucor. This is a plate, and the right one is the fungus. This is another one, Blastomyces. This is another one, fungal colony from fin of fish 14 on SDA, Alternaria. Well, all these fungus, they are pathogenic to fishes. This is another one, pinkish white fungal colony from fish Fusarium, separated spread colony. That is another one. This is another one, whitish fungal colony taken from anal fin of fish 24 and from sample 2 on STA, and this was unidentified. We couldn't identify. We'll work on this in future. This is the pure culture. This is the second phase, that from most of these fungal we isolated, we made a pure colony. You could find the right side colony is almost uniform, and that indicates that it was a pure. This is a procedure we would normally adopt to get the this thing. Conclusion: both Lapia species, or Oreochromis aureus and C. zeli, showed fungal infection. These fungi are considered as pathogenic fungi to fish. Fins were most affected areas by the fungal infection in both fishes. The former must not lead on the myth that tilapia is a disease-resistant fish. Fish must be grown in the best possible way. There's a need to conduct a detailed study on fungal disease in tilapia, as this fish is becoming a popular among the fish farmers in Pakistan. We are grateful to our university for funding this study, and thank you very much. Well, it ranged from 28 to 30 degrees centigrade, if you're talking about the plates. For culture, that was 28 to 30 degrees. It depends on the duration, how long you place your plate in that. Okay, so it ranged from 5 to 7 days, quite lengthy period. So that's still, so we'll look into that. Thank you. Sorry? Where did I? Yes, I think this was from two sources. One was from Punjab University Research Farm, and the second was from your office. That was in Manama Hatchery. Well, there could be. You're not claiming that was from your hatchery. Okay. But anyway, I showed you the picture, if there could have been a... There was another source also. There could be another source also, that is from Maridke. There could be, but I'm sure this was from your office. I'm sorry? Well, these two samples, one was from our own source, that was Punjab University Research Fish Farm, and the second was from the Manama Hatchery. That's it. Okay, okay. Thank you.
Thank you so much. Now we have got a Skype presentation by Dr. Subhash Hajeri. He is plant pathologist and lab operational manager in Central California Tristeza Education Agency, USA. His title of today is RNA in Insect Pest Management. Please welcome him for his Skype talk.
The idea of integrated pest management is at the heart of ag science and ag management. So in the U.S., organic opportunities in production, that's where it's landscaping or conservation management control is the annual and sometimes the only tool used by those for pest management. But, you know, still the control is most prevalent because it provides solutions. However, the technical problem is not a sustainable approach. So there is a potential for pesticide resistance development in pest populations, and others not safe for the environment. Hence, there is a demand for this eco-friendly or community habits of pest management, and a lot of researchers are exploring from these new multilateral methods. And two of the most promising tools are RNA improvements, also called as RNAi, and genome editing by CRISPR-Cas system. I'm going to talk about RNAi today. Next slide, please. You might have heard the names like gene silencing, post-classic gene silencing, and others. Now, there are a lot of methods to work RNAi from that. Next slide, please. When the samples were trying to enhance the flower color, but what they found was the loss of pigment in some of the protein. So that time they were not able to explain the phenomenon, but they discovered it as a post-production, where both the endogenous and the plant genes are co-silenced. Next slide, please. Later, the elucidated this phenomenon of RNAi and the human, where they advertise that when the silencing phenomenon is often at the RNA level, and that the dose and the RNA plays a key role. So, the feedback observed was very much similar to the gene map of human. So, next slide, please. So, because of very discovery and the widespread use of this RNAi is included in pretty much everything, like on medical science, to ag, and medical science. So, because of the widespread use of the award for prize, Zoology 2006. So, next slide, please. So, what is this RNAi? You might this I have found that the carbon at the end or at the then next slide, the phenomenon that happens in the transition is called EDS or plastic fertilizer. The one that happens at the RNA is called post-plastic fertilizer. So, my review of the post-plastic fertilizer. Next slide. So, this is a general update of the AI. On this slide, on the left side, you can see the one population that's called the hydrogen population. And there is another population on the right side, it's called the cyanide population. So, this hydrogen population is produced by the host by its own gene variation.
Which is
passable by sodium. So our iron was that the iron is something supplied by the insect. So what we did was we So insect has five stages. These are called the baby stages and one other stage. So we want to target specifically which is meant for the baby development. So to target the team, we have to identify the life stage of insect. So what we do is we do a mass spectrum analysis and then we want the fifth install for the other stage and the highest expectation of the team. That's all that. So what we did was we basically collect all these fifth install things, next cycles. So what we did was we synthesize the first carbon and apply optically to these baby names. And this baby names and they develop into feathers. And surprisingly you can see they develop the white wings. And these white wings gain a top of fly. So eventually this is something that. So this is the first demonstration that we showed that there is a real connection of fly and eye.
Which are going to
bring all this RNA out of the mantra. So these RNAs can travel the whole time without the carbon dioxide work. So when we knock in whatever was, we want a part of the fish, but we can see this phenomena going to be back. And I also want to have a look that we can transfer this phenomena to other varieties of fish without paying the kinds of tax. We can't modify the existing plants. So the third aspect of this is the device, which is I have, is actually induced this RNA inside. What happens when we
Okay. Sorry.
So, here, the cows are there. Some growers trying to control the pigs, but hay was not trying to sell it. Happened was, the growers found they are putting a stick areas. All growers of pesticide in the same time. So, that's one of the things they could know. But still, you know, they were very quick in trying to do all this. So that's why they lost a lot of time in the industry. But the technology is still developing roads, but can have to fight the predict. I put it to be meat and some oranges, not 60. Very, very big for the rest. So right now going on. No, the EPA, Environmental Protection Agency, and there is one more of FDA, Food and Drug Administration, and the state. So just evaluating. So it has to be, you know, rigorous step. Then only, you know, it is allowed to be used.
Thank you so very much. Thank you again. Now we will be continuing with our speaker session.
From Lahore College for Women University, and the topic of our presentation is histopathological study of Labia rojita challenged with Pseudomonas.
Assalamu alaikum. I'm Smaran Purves, and my topic of presentation is histological study of the Labia rojita challenged with Pseudomonas aeruginosa bacterium. First introduction: aquaculture basically involves the cultivation of the fresh water and the salt water population. It is the fastest growing animal food producing sector that provide the food to the in all around the world, the food with the high energy content, vitamin and the protein level. It is considered as the vital source of the food. Labia rojita is the fish of the carp family. It basically contributes to 35% of the major Indian carp production. It is considered as economically and the commercially important fish, and it is highly sensitive to the factor under the consideration. So it is easily adaptable to the laboratory conditions to conduct the experimental studies in the laboratories. No doubt the fisheries and aquaculture is the one of the fastest growing sector. One of the major problem with the this sector is the fish diseases. They are classified into two categories: the pathogenic diseases and the non-pathogenic diseases. Pathogenic diseases are those caused by the virus, bacteria, fungi, parasites, crustaceans, etc. And the non-pathogenic diseases are those cause other than the pathogens. The factors involved in the non-pathogenic diseases includes the hereditary changes, genomic alterations, ecological tumor, or the environmental factors. Among these, the pathogenic diseases are considered the one of the most serious problematic to the aquaculture. Among them, bacterium Pseudomonas aeruginosa is the one of the serious bacterium cause the diseases to the fish, fishes. Pseudomonas aeruginosa is a ubiquitous gram-negative and motile rod-shaped bacterium. It is the normal inhabitant of the gastrointestinal tract of the fish and considered an opportunistic pathogen which causes the attack to the fishes because when the fishes are already immunocompromised or have any other viral or the bacterial secondary infections. These are the some common bacterial infection. the tail and the fin roots, red sore disease, motile serum nas, septicemia disease, white outer ring disease, fish ulcer infection, dorsal muscles infection of fish. These all type of the bacterial infection cause the serious economic loss to the aquaculture sector. There is a need to control such type of the infection to enhance the economic level in all around the world. Aims and objective of my study were to find out the relative percentage survival rate of the Libya rahita against the Pseudomonas aeruginosa challenge, or to determine the changes in the blood cells morphology after challenge with the Pseudomonas aeruginosa bacterium in the Libya rahita, or to determine the changes in the histological parameter against the Pseudomonas aeruginosa in Libya rahita. Plan of work and the methodology, the experimental design was basically here are the results. First, the clinical signs and the symptoms. We noted the clinical signs and symptoms of the fishes. These are the pictures from the experimental fish. Significant and the visible clinical signs and the symptoms of the infection can be easily seen in these pictures. Infectious outgrowths are the more prominent over the fish skin. Redness of the fish scales, fish tail and the fish fins were highly prominent in the experimental fishes. Relative percentage survival rate of the fishes was determined at the different different days, the 5, 10 and the 15th. At the 5 days of the post-infection, the survival rate of the experimental fishes were significantly reduced when compared to the control group. At the 10 days of the treatment, as compared to the 5 days, the no change in the survival rate of the experimental group was determined. But the significant reduction in the experimental group survival rate was determined at the 10 days of the post-infection. At the 15 days of the post-infection, the survival rate of the experimental fishes that were injected with the Pseudomonas aeruginosa bacterium were further reduced as compared to the control group. Here are the results of the blood smear analysis. This is a picture from the normal or the control group. You can easily see the red blood cells and the white blood normal morphology of the red blood cells and the white blood cells. Here are the pictures from the experimental group. Red blood cells and the white blood cells were completely ruptured and devoid their cellular organelles because of the highly bacterial infestation or the bacterial infection. These are the some picture of from the histological studies. At the right side, the transverse section in the liver of the labia rahita showing the normal morphology in the control group. Hepatocytes, sinocytes and hepatopancreas were the normal in the control group, while in the bacterial injected group, the all the cells of the liver were highly ruptured, and you can easily see the hepatocytes obsession and focal necrosis, vacuolation, hemorrhage or the degenerative hepatic sinocytes in bacterial injected group. Ye move nahi kar raha. Here are the pictures from the histology of the kidney. At the left side is the picture of the control group, shows the transverse section in the kidney of the labia rahita with the normal morphology of the glomerulus, tubular system, Bowman's space, distal convoluted tubule and the proximal tubules all were in the normal, shows the normal morphology. At the right side is the picture from the infected group, shows the device changes including reducing the congestion of the blood capillaries, having a process of the glomerular structure, disruption of the hepatopoietic tissues by the heavy infestation of the bacterial community, inflammation of the kidney tissues, regeneration and the vacuolation. Now we can conclude or to summarize our studies by the simply in these sentences, the like the in the negative untreated control group, no clinical signs of the bacterial infection were seen. Relative percentage survival rate of the fishes was 100%. Blasmeyer revealed the normal morphology of the blood cells, including white blood cells or red blood cells. No changes in the histomorphology of the fish organs were found. In the bacterial intoxicated group, we can summarize all the results that this significant clinical signs of sign and symptom of the bacterial infection was recorded, and the statistically significant decrease in the relative percentage of the fish survival rate was found as compared to the control or the normal group. Blood cells morphology was completely lost, and the highly significant histological changes were found in the in organs. We can conclude that the Pseudomonas aeruginosa is a highly fish specific pathogen that caused the gradual pathological symptoms, which became the severe and the massive. At the end of the experimental trial, it proved that the Labiorhita might be the susceptible fish towards the susceptible attack of the ubiquitous bacterium Pseudomonas aeruginosa, at least in their intensive fish culture condition. Future perspectives include the direct this study basically indicates the direct correlation between the fish infection state and the fish health status, which can be helpful in establishment of the new strategies for the control and the treatment of the fish infection. This knowledge is highly significant to provide the information to the fish farmer for the maintenance of the fish health, for their improvement of the economic level of the aquaculture and the fisheries. Future studies will be helpful to understand the molecular pathway of the bacterial infection. Thank you so much. On Labiorhita survival, behavior, growth and hematology.
Assalamu alaikum everyone, my name is Saha Nadeem and the topic of my presentation. Today the topic of my presentation is effect of zinc oxide nanoparticles on Labiorhita related to its survival, behavior, growth and hematology. So let's begin with the introduction. According to FAO, aquaculture industry is increasing at a faster rate as compared to the world capture production. As you can see in the graph, that combined annual growth rate of aquaculture production is growing at a faster rate as compared to the world capture production. So why aquaculture industry is increasing at a faster rate as compared to the capture production? This is because of its significant role that aquaculture industry is playing in strengthening a country's economy, and also because we are living in a world where world population is increasing at an alarming rate, and we need some alternate food source to feed such a huge number of population, and fishes can serve as a remarkable alternate food source because of its high protein content and various vitamins and minerals. Can you imagine, only 150 gram of a fish can provide up to 50 to 60% of an adult's total daily protein requirements. This is the pie chart showing the proportion of different aquaculture areas, and we can see that 37.4% of aquaculture production was from freshwater fishes, and fortunately Pakistan has 193 freshwater fish species, out of which 86 are considered as a species of special importance. That's why we have selected Labiorhita for our present study, which is a freshwater fish species and constitute 75% of the aquaculture production in Pakistan. So aquaculture and nanotechnology. Whenever we use nanoparticles in various industries, it is known as nanotechnology. Nanotechnology uses nanoparticles. Nanoparticles are the particles which range in size from 1 to 100 nanometer in diameter, and because of their smaller size, they have very unique chemical and physical properties that make them beneficial for various industries. And same happens with the aquaculture. In aquaculture, we use nanoparticles for encapsulation of food, for protecting them from microbial contamination, for nanofiltration of water. As whenever the usage of something increases, the chances of its being released in the environment and to come in contact with human and aquatic bodies increases. So there is a need to evaluate the possible threats and risks of nanoparticles for humans. The nanoparticles are of two types, the inorganic nanoparticles and the organic nanoparticles. Because of the abundance of inorganic nanoparticles in nature, we selected zinc oxide nanoparticles for our present study. Zinc oxide nanoparticles, due to their remarkable chemical properties, are used in various industries. As you can see here, the rubber industry, the electrolyte industries and many more. The aims and objectives of our present study is to observe the changes in routine pattern behaviors and the survival of fish, and to note the hematological alteration produced by the zinc oxide nanoparticles exposure, and also to note the changes in internal organs of fish. For this purpose, we have designed an experiment in which we acclimatized the fishes. After acclimatization, we divided them in two groups. The first one is the control group, which is an untreated group, and the second one is the zinc oxide nanoparticle treated group. The experimental trial was for 15 days, and the zinc oxide nanoparticle concentration was selected 8.33 milligram per liter. We have analyzed, after 15 days of exposure, we have analyzed the fish in both groups. Behavioral, hematological and pathological analysis was done. The results of the study: the survival of the fish was very much reduced in the zinc oxide nanoparticles treated group. As you can see in the graph, that the survival rate of control group was 100% because no fish was found dead, while the survival rate of zinc oxide nanoparticle treated group was reduced to 12.5%. And a different behavior observed in both groups also found altered and disturbed. The swimming, hovering and comatose behavior of zinc oxide nanoparticle treated fish were very much disturbed. The phenotypic examination was also done. As you can see here, the control fishes have gills that are red in color and lots of blood are present, while the gills of control zinc oxide nanoparticle treated group were pale in color and also have blackened areas around the gills or on the gills. The fish was dissected to note the damages or changes produced by the zinc oxide nanoparticle. The control fish have completely healthy organs, while the zinc oxide nanoparticle treated fishes were slimy in nature, and they were very much the organs were very much damaged. The morphology of cells was also noted. The red blood cells in the zinc oxide nanoparticle treated group were very much damaged. They don't have their elliptical shape, and also the cells line were found damaged. Effect on growth: the zinc oxide nanoparticle treated group showed slower growth rates as compared to the control group, as you can see in the column graph. The hematological parameters were also altered, and all the total leukocyte counts and the total erythrocyte count was reduced as compared to control group. So the conclusion of our study, that zinc oxide nanoparticles exposure ultimately disturbed the survival and behavior of Liberohita, and the pathological alterations in gills and internal organs indicated that sublethal concentration of zinc oxide nanoparticles caused severe damage, resulting in dysfunction and ultimately death of fish. And due to the invasion of zinc oxide nanoparticles through gills or body surfaces, the total leukocyte count and the total erythrocyte count was also reduced. So what is the significance of our whole study? That the pathological and hematological changes can be considered as a biomarker, and also the Liberohita can be used as a test fish for zinc oxide nanoparticle toxicity. Recommendation, what I recommend is the regular monitoring of zinc oxide nanoparticles must be done to avoid fish mortality, and also the production limits, the production of zinc oxide nanoparticles in various industries must be monitored and must be specified, and further studies must be conducted to evaluate the positive and negative effects of zinc oxide nanoparticles. Thank you.
Is evaluation of genotoxic potential of phthalates on carp.
Assalamu alaikum. Dear faculty member, honorable guests and students, my topic of presentation is evaluation of genotoxic potential of phthalate on grass carp. First of all, we must be familiar that what does mean of phthalates. Phthalates are non-halogenated esters of phthalic acid, which are widely used in different industrial and consumer-oriented applications. Because of their worldwide consumption by human beings, they have been largely diffused into the environment. Few of them, like dimethyl phthalate, dienoctyl phthalate, and dibutyl phthalate, have been listed as priority pollutant by China National Environmental Monitoring Center and US Environmental Protection Agency. Basically, there are three primary ways of their entrance into the body of the fish. The first one is the dermal, through absorption by the skin while swimming in the contaminated water. The second one is the inhalation through lungs. The third one is the orally drinking any contaminated water or feed upon any contaminated prey. While my concern related to dimethyl phthalate and dienoctyl phthalate, dimethyl phthalate is colorless oily liquid with a slightly sweet odor. This is used as a plasticizer and an insect repellent for the personal use against any biting insect. This is a hazardous substance which enters into the environment by industrial discharge. While dye and octyl phthalate have been listed as core pollutant by various regulatory agencies because of its low solubility into water and toxicity in the immune system. Dienoctyl phthalate is commonly used as plasticizer and found in variety of consumer products. Nowadays, phthalate ester have recently attracted special attention of scientific community and general public as a consequence of their worldwide consumption, high usage, and their suspected carcinogenic and endocrine disrupting disorders. While micronucleus assay is a mutagenicity test system that is used to determine those chemicals which induce the formation of small membrane bound DNA fragments either in neogenicity or clastogenicity. Neogenicity is the loss of whole chromosome while the clastogenicity is the loss of DNA fragments. These fragments are unable to migrate during the anaphase of the cell division, which incorporated in the daughter cells, and micronucleus assays serve as a biomarker of cytogenetic damages. The main purpose of micronucleus assays is to determine those chemicals which alter the chromosomal structure. This diagram shows the mechanism of micronuclei formation. In the A segment, we can easily observe the acentric treatment. While micronucleus test in fish, peripheral erythrocyte of fish have a high incidence of micronuclei after exposure of toxic chemicals, while the nuclear lesions are genotoxic analog of micronuclei, which could be caused by toxic chemicals. And nuclear lesion could be precursor of micronuclei, which might be a signal of cytogenetic damage in aquatic species. Now come to the aims and objective of my study work. To determine the effect of dimethyl phthalate and dienoctyl phthalate on the growth of grass carp, to investigate the physicochemical parameter of water in relation to phthalate toxicity, to evaluate the impact of phthalate on hematology of grass carp, to determine the synergistic effect of toxicant in relation to change in serum protein content of fish body, and the last one was to analyze the genotoxic potential of phthalate by using micronucleic assay and nuclear lesions. My methodology basically contained different phases. The first phase was fish samples collection. Healthy juveniles of C. idila were procured from the Himalaya fish hatchery Maridke, and they were kept in the 120 liter of glass aquaria while their acclimatization period were 2 weeks. My work based in the Fisheries and Aquaculture Lab, Department of Zoology, LCW. The next phase was the dose exposure. After acclimatization period, fish were divided into two groups. The first one was the control group, while the second one is the treated group. The treated group were further divided into three groups, group B, C, and D. The group B contained the exposure of dimethyl phthalate for the 3 days, while the concentration of dimethyl phthalate were 1.5 microgram per liter. And the group C contained the concentration of dienoctyl phthalate of 1.4 microgram per liter, while the group D contained the mixture of dimethyl phthalate and dienoctyl phthalate, and the concentration were 10 microgram per liter. This was the stock solution prepared by me. Now come to the hematological evaluation and determination of protein contents. Impact of phthalate were determined by the hematological parameters and change in protein content. Blood were taken from the gills of the fish to determine the hemoglobin, hematocrit, total erythrocyte count, MCHC platelet count, while the total protein content were determined by the method following the tripathy et al. This diagram shows the collection of blood from the gills of the fish. The next phase is genotoxic study by micronucleus assay. Basically, micronuclei are similar to the macronuclei, but the difference is that they are smaller in size as compared to the macronuclei. The micronuclei were evaluated by their shape refractivity following the method of Fench et al., and they were calculated by counting 1,000 erythrocytes, while the nuclear lesion determined by the staining process. Nuclear lesions were characterized into 9 major types following the method of Casco et al. This diagram shows the formation staining process. Come to the results. There were behavioral changes as well as postmortem examination were determined. Behavioral changes were significant at the start of the exposure and within the couple of hours after the exposure, but leading with the passage of time, the behavioral changes goes on the normal but less than the control fish, while the postmortem examination showed the foul smell and change in the gill color as well. Now come to the general health assessment and biometric data. Condition factor was recorded for the evaluation of general health condition, physiological impairment, morphology and necroscopy. While the control fish showed the better quality, normal and better condition, while the condition factor showed the treated group showed the condition factor lower than the control one. As we can easily observe from the D group, there is a low value of condition factor as compared to the group A. The physicochemical parameters were also determined to check the water quality of the treated fish as well as the control fish. The physicochemical parameter that were recorded almost in the permissible range that was determined by the WHO and APH 2012. Effect of phthalate on serum protein profile of C. idela were also determined by using the method of biurate method. There was a decrease in serum protein of exposed group after the exposure, and there were a comparison of 15 days exposure period show very highly significant low value as compared to the control group. These values are presented as, while the hematological analysis of C. idela were also determined and there were a fluctuation in their values. Hematological parameters showed the significantly higher values after exposure to mixture of dimethyl phthalate and dienoctyl phthalate, while increase in the RBCs production to counterbalance and immunize the immune system of the fish till to its survival rate. Assessment of micronuclei and other nuclear alteration were determined. Erythrocyte of treated group were morphologically abnormal and there were 9 major lesions that was determined, while the control fish showed the normal morphology of erythrocyte as compared to the treated groups. Different nuclear lesions were determined, which include the binuclei, which contain 2 nuclei in a single cell, while the multinuclei were also determined, which contain more than 2 nuclei in a single cell. You can easily observe from the diagram, there first shows that the micronuclei, the second shows that the binucleated, the third shows that the lobe nuclei, the fourth one shows that the 8-shaped nuclei. Blood nuclei were also determined. The group D, C showed the different morphology, which include the notch nuclei. Notch nuclei, basically, this is a kidney-shaped nuclei that we determined, and the binucleated erythrocyte with nucleoplasmic bridge were also determined. Undamaged nuclei, they were neither normal nor abnormal, but they are concave in shape. This we can easily observe from this diagram, and this shows the morphological abnormalities of the dienoctyl exposure. While the mixture shows also different abnormality, which include the blood nuclei basically they formed at the early stages of the apoptotic erythrocyte, and there is an irregular bulge in the plasma membrane. As there is a different diagram which shows the which showed the dienoctyl and dimethyl mixture composition. This diagram shows the prevalence percentage and frequency of micronuclei and additional nuclear abnormalities in peripheral blood of treated cells. You can easily observe there is a high frequency of micronuclei as compared to the other one. After micronuclei, notch nuclei were the most frequent in the nuclear lesion. This diagram shows the comparison of prevalence percentage of micronuclei and nuclear abnormalities in different groups. Statistical correlation were also determined, which concluded that the older micronuclei and nuclear lesions were time and concentration dependent. And they, I concluded that phthalates are, have severe concern about potential, so there must be a great concern to control the their entrance into the water bodies for the survival of fish, which indirectly affect on the human health. Thank you. Any question?
Minutes maximum.
Our next speaker is Ms. Fiza Mahmood from Lahore College for Women University for the presentation of identification of time of gonadal differentiation in grass carp and Ketla.
We'll be going with a Skype session with Dr. Junaid right now. Introducing about Dr. Junaid Rehman, he is a postdoctoral research associate in agrochemical drug discovery program of NCNPR. Dr. Junaid received his PhD from Qaid-e-Azam University, Islamabad in 2010. PhD research was completed in UC Davis, USA and National Agriculture Research Center, Islamabad, Pakistan. He worked as a research fellow for 5 years in botanical pesticides, NARS, Islamabad. He has published 10 papers in botanical pesticides. His research expertise are in phytochemistry, insect behaviors, insect physiology, endocrinology, botanical pesticides. He served in research development department of FMSC, USA-based multinational company for 2.5 years. He has extensive contributions in research and development. He is working on to develop bed bugs control strategy based on the natural products. He's also studied impact of natural products on the behavior and reproductive physiology of against olive, fruit fly, and its parasitoids. He also collaborated and worked at Canary Research and Extension Center, Parlier Frenso. Please welcome him for his topic on pest management with natural products.
Good morning. And coming back in, so India, Pakistan,
So all these lesser products will lead to NI. NI is called the nasty perspired chemical. So why go for the lesser products? So there are two pieces of meat. Number one is the availability. They are like too much in the environment, not. The second is the diversity. Each plant, each animal, each fungi, they don't have the limbs like we have, okay? They don't walk the way we have. They have their own senses, so they know how different themselves are. And we use those defensive mechanisms or those defensive situations, either in plant, animals, or animal. We use them to design the new molecules which can control the other the best of anything under the control. So how it works? If we take the industry perspective, then they were putting on a synthetic way. They synthesize a molecule, they go for the bio acid, and they evaluate the compound electric acid, and they go for a QSAR, quantitative structure activity relationship. That's the way the industry works in synthetic chemical. If you talk about the natural products, the process is a little bit extensive. It starts with the section of energy, then we do a sort of microbiome assay, and then we evaluate the results. Then we decide either to purify or not to purify, okay, and initial following the systematic biological systematic calculation, then we follow the step. Then again we perform the biological and then we do it. So in this case, the NPs, the synthesis and QSAR comes in the air. It's very expensive for that. So to reach to the QSAR national product, it takes a lot of time. Okay, so that's the way like how the NPs they work. Okay. But here in this slide you're seeing like if you're looking at the plant, the two key are the words they are in the blue, it's the bioassay. Remember one thing, bioassay is the most important part in evaluation, and this is the least area we work on in any case. Okay. So, if you want to understand the natural product, you have to design your own bioassay. Available bioassay may not work for you, but the format they do not to do not explore. Okay, so that's the important part. Need to work on designing a bioassay. What question we need to get addressed by using that bioassay. About the system treatment in India, then you are not going to get your answers. When you are not going to get your answers, you cannot reach the conclusion of this topic. So, emphasize more on bioassay. I'm going to give you an example on mosquito repellents for the quick way to design the bioassay system. So in this slide, there are different methodologies for testing the environment. So we call it in vitro or in vivo. If you go to in vitro, you come from KMB, you'll see a small picture, it's a six chamber device or an apparatus. It's very expensive. So, a small chamber. So, if you are testing the environment, the chamber is very small. It's not like the exact reference. It's more like a confined space to reaction. So, that's one. Second thing is the spatial reference assay. Big chamber to the center. Then, the white part of the structure. You at the same time, you are the treatment and the repellent treatment and then the these are the beneficial attacks with any immune system and intestinal immunity. And these immunobiological proposals probably in developing countries because the other individual matter is very expensive. Let's talk about the cane children, which you can see in the picture. It's about like costing around like 5 to 6 thousand dollars between five such guys. But another problem with the interview is your data is not available. So in the interview, now we have a few articles that you can study to show that okay, I have already got into the data and how we are doing. So the next slide, financial method, these are the variations that we from virus to virus from country to country. Then you look at from 30 to 60 area, and then in the case we have 100 to 500 and the insert the chicken arm the case 1 to 5 years, and then the report from landing, biting, a number of problems.
So we figured out that we need something which is
is easy to assemble, easy to render, and you can have the reproducibility of the data. So, for example, virus involved NCNPR, the Valley Virus, National Center for Natural Flora, Army, Navy, after the sample we got formed. And we got it published in Algebra Pomology in 2016, 2016. So how it works and what are the material that we need? We need only three things. Number one, the mug water. It's called the material that I think about the awesome. Not more than with rubies or like technology. And you need a plan viewer. It's a record of these people who need that basically kind of plexiglass. Plexiglass is easier to pass that. You just need 13 by 10 centimeters of plexiglass sheet. You've got a few pieces. Lay out 4 by 3 centimeters of your inside. You basically attach that feather on the plate because it is black plate inside, which has aluminum inside, and it keeps when you pass the feather. And fortunately, works on voltage is inversely proportional, directly proportional to resistance. So, if you increase the voltage, it will suffer anything. If you keep the voltage, it will suffer anything. But the resistance is going to be there. So, the form of the plate is set as a reservoir. You can put any water, you attach a flash, with the plexiglass sheet, with any silicone method, it will be awesome. So, you can see in the illustration of the base going down on the background. How it works? It works, this is a
the case. So it is a happy document. Yeah. Just
Thank you, Dr. Junaid. A wonderful talk.
Thank you, Rabil. We are already late, quite late. Thank you, Rabil. We are quite late, and there are a number of speakers. I'd like to thank the organization and the organizers and the leadership of this university, Professor Dr. Usma Qureshi and Dr. Farhanda and Dr. Shagufta Naz, and also the aquaculture faculty, Dr. Shafak Fatma, Dr. Ghazala, Dr. Kamal, and my other co-chair, Dr. Kashfa Nagmana, to give us opportunity and design a special session for the aquaculture. FAQ stand for frequently asked questions, and over here it's a short form of fisheries and aquaculture. So there was not much time provided, or the audience could not participate in the question answer session. I'd like to thank Dr. Tariq Saab to assist us in asking the question. Well, the title of this conference said New Trends in Natural Sciences from Basics to Applied. Basics to Applied. I represent private sector. No doubt I work with the academia research institution. I provide a platform with a linkage between the industry and the academia research. Now the time is coming very fast, and time is flying very fast rather. Lahore College University, Lahore College has become the university, and no doubt it is one of the largest university, women university. But you have a competition with the other universities as well. There are competitors in Pakistan, and I'd like to thank Dr. Prakanda when I met her back in 2012, and she took the initiative to extend this fisheries courses also, and give the strength to the zoology department. Only one request, that please do research should be translated into the applied and hand over to the industry. Create industry linkages. Although we are fifth populous country, maybe sixth, by 2050 we are going to cross like 300 million. One of the slides in the morning, Dr. Agmana mentioned about the capture and consumption in Asia is equal. In USA, three times fish is consumed as produced locally. 180 million or 160 million figures is totally produced, 50% from the capture and 50 from the aquaculture. Where Pakistan is standing? What is the per capita consumption? Hardly 2 kilograms. Yes, don't be depressed. From the marketing point of view, yes, there is a lot of opportunity. The more you will produce, all will be consumed in Pakistan. The good example is initiative of the American Soybean Association, the Feeding Pakistan program. We introduced the first soy-based feed in Pakistan, and also helped the private sector to develop the first tilapia hatchery in Pakistan. The opportunity starts emerging. The fresh graduates, both male and females, have been trained in this program, and all of them is being absorbed by the industry and the fishery departments, Sindh and Punjab, as well as fish development board. My message over here is that there is a future now in aquaculture. Trust me, whatever the land and the resources, particularly the water resources available, we need to increase the per acre yield. We have a lot of room to increase the productivity through what? She mentioned in the morning two constraints and challenges. And luckily, we have the available land and the waters. And I know sometimes the political issue comes up with the provincial departments about the water scarcity. This is going to be scarcity. But their productivity was very low. After the introduction of the floating feed, particularly soy based. Why soy based? The capture in the marine is depleting very fast. Fish meal prices are very high. We are eliminating the animal source of protein in the feed. Like a good example of the poultry, they make soy and corn based feed to eliminate the health issues, to address the health issues. As Dr. Iqbal Saab rightly mentioned, and Dr. Tariq Saab contributed in that discussion, the tilapia production is increasing. In 2012, there was hardly 100,000 tilapia imported. When we say the tilapia, it doesn't mean that the wild tilapia. We are talking about the sex reversal tilapia, 98% male. Local hatchery now producing 2.3 million, and 4 million tilapia was stocked this year. 4 million tilapia fry was stocked this year, and 5 feed mill has been established. What is this showing? The growth and the demand is increasing. For you young aquaculturists, the future is there for you. Trust me, there is a lot of opportunity available in Pakistan. Thank you very much, and taking the opportunity, I like to thank Dr. Shakuri Saab who joined us, and I like to present Dr. Shakuri Saab a copy of the aquaculture handbook, and to Dr. Tariq Saab also, please. You come, Dr. Tariq Saab and Dr. Shakuri Saab, please join us at this stage. I like to present you the copy of the aquaculture handbook, and to Dr. Kashfaz Nagmana also. And after that, we are going to have a group photo with all the presenters, and we are going to give them the complimentary copy of the manual of tilapia. Thank you very much.
Speakers of this session, please, aap upar aake ek photograph ke liye aa jaiye, please. All the speakers from this session, please. Kindly please gather for a photograph.